Our study last time in relation to the Jehovah's Witnesses, we come about probably halfway or near to halfway through the material that I have, and just as a very brief review now to sort of bring you up on a thing. They are people that they reject the Trinity, that is, that the Godhead being a Trinity, a tri-unity. And according to the Word of God, you find reference to the Trinity in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 and 27, 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 14, Matthew chapter 28, and direct statement on it in 1 John chapter 5 and verse number 7. And what they're dealing with is what is known as Arianism, and this is kind of a rehash of what was supposedly settled once and forevermore, dealt with at the Council of Nicaea in 325 A.D., and ultimately supposedly put to sleep in 381 at Constantinople. At least that's the idea that supposedly took place. And they resurrected the thing. I call the name of Charles Taz Russell, Razzmatazz Russell. He kind of put a hex on these people and pulled off a slick shot. And anyhow, along about 1874 or so, they're about 70, 74, 79, that area there, this fellow come up with something that was put to sleep for a lot of years, and of course it rejects Jesus Christ as being God in the flesh. And now these guys in this movement, it'll be Russell, so sometimes they're called Russellites. After him in 1909, a fellow became their legal man there. He was an attorney. His name was Joseph Rutherford. They called him Judge Rutherford. And in 1916, he took over after the death of Charles Russell. He took the movement over there, and he was leader of the movement. Up to 1942, when he passed on, Nathan Knorr took over. And all these fellows, none of them have a testimony. Like, you know, I could ask somebody here for a testimony, and they'd give me a testimony as when they got saved and how good the Lord's been to them and how the Lord means so much to them. And no problem. But, you know, these fellows, none of them had a testimony like that. They lived and died without a testimony of any sort at all. And this outfit here, we call them a very deceptive outfit because they fool around changing names. And I think I listed about six or seven different names that they went under over the years until finally they've settled in with a title called Jehovah's Witnesses. But they began as Zion's Watchtower Tract Society. They went on to the Watchtower and Tract Society of Pennsylvania and Dawn Bible Students, and on down the line, about a half a dozen names they've had over the years. I told you about them being deceptive and that they play games with the Negroes. I said that because of the fact that over the years you have in the movement about 50% of them being black, and yet you have in leadership in New York, you have out of one time in 1960, you had out of 400 people at main headquarters in New York, only two blacks. I said, just play games with those people, and those poor people, somebody's always doing the same thing with them. All right, one very important thing is that they reduce the Lord Jesus Christ to the level of the devil. And they call him a created being. Not that he's the creator, not that he's God the Son back in eternity, but that he's a created being. He's the first created being that God the Father made. That's not true. Whenever things began to be created, it's Jesus Christ himself that did the creating. And they call him Michael the Archangel. And that is before he came to the earth here. They said that he was Michael the Archangel in his pre-human state. That being true, Michael the Archangel would not even rebuke the devil. They not only reduced him down to the level of the devil, they put him lower than that. Michael would not take the liberty of some, you know, people just trying to be wise, some comments they make along the lines of the devil. But Michael said, "The Lord rebuke thee, O Satan." He wouldn't even do it himself. And so they say that he was Michael the Archangel. In other words, they're putting the devil over top of the Lord Jesus Christ. So anyhow, for some reasons I gave you there, I say that one of the major things that you and I would call them a wicked bunch of witnesses for is what they've done to the Lord Jesus Christ. They've stripped him of his deity. They said he was not God, but he was a lesser God. And they said that he was not God the Son, but just the Son of God. And back in eternity, instead of being God the Son, he was Michael the Archangel. And not only that, when he came to this earth, he was just a man. For 30 years, up until the time that he was baptized, he was not God. And that type of thing like that. So we said that just a wicked bunch of people to even use the title Jehovah's Witnesses. All right, now another thing, and got about a half a dozen more for you this evening. But another thing is they revised the Bible. They revise the Bible so that light becomes darkness. Whenever you get messing around with the Word of God, you're turning the lights out. Whenever you take a chain, that's a chain through the Word of God that cannot be broken, and you break that chain, you're turning the lights out. And that's what they do. Now, for example, the Bible that they have produced, they've gone to the wrong source for what they call light. They've gone to the source that God said not to go to. They've gone to Egypt as their source for the light. And this bunch of people here, they have nothing to do with Roman Catholics. And they're always preaching against Roman Catholics and talking about Roman Catholics. And yet, believe it or not, they went to the same place that Rome went to for the Bible. They don't even know that they're twin with Rome. You know, they just don't realize that, you know, Rome gets her Bible from Vaticanus, manuscript that comes out of Egypt, Alexandria, Egypt, is under lock and key at Rome now. And so they get their source from that same text, their Bible, that's the source of their Bible. And so Rome and this bunch are twins when it comes to the Bible. They just don't even know that. Vaticanus being the text, Egyptian text, and the thing is under lock and key at Rome. They revise the Bible. They go to the wrong text for the Bible, and of course they, in their Bible, and turn out the lights, they reject the Trinity. I'll give you an example. 1 John chapter 5 and verse number 7, take your Bible and look at it. 1 John 5 and verse number 7, you take a good look at it. Let me read you what they've got in their Bible. They call 1 John 5, 7. Don't Bible now. 1 John 5 and verse number 7. Are you looking at it? Doesn't it say there are three that bear record in heaven? John, read it to me.
There are three that bear record in heaven. The Father, the Word, the Holy Ghost, and these three are one.
These three are one. Direct statement on the Trinity, the triunity of the Godhead. Here's what you got in J.W. Bible in 1 John 5 verse 7. It says, for there are three witness bearers. That's it. That's it, period. For there are three witness bearers. And they go on and say, the Father in verse 8, the Spirit and the water and the blood, and these three are in agreement. You know what they do? They take part of verse number 8 and try to make the thing as though it's verse number 7. They're a bunch of crooked people. They're a bunch of people that with their Bibles, they take the light out that God has for you in His Word. You know, there's some things that people can't get outside the Bible. There's some things you can get without a Bible. There are some things like Solomon, a wise man, Ecclesiastes. There are some things that he had right. Not all of Ecclesiastes is wrong. Some of Ecclesiastes is right. There are some things that people have wisdom and keep their eyes open, don't go through this life with blinders on. There are some things that they can come up with that are actually right, and they got sense enough to see it just from the human standpoint. They can see through some things and see the end of some things and know how things are going to go, know what's right and know what's wrong. They can't get it all. When it comes to the Godhead, it takes the Bible to let you know that these three are one. And J.W. has turned that light out, and that's according to their own Bible. The statement is disaster in 1 John 5 and verse number 7. Another thing they mess up with, and that is the when it comes to Bibles, along the lines of Luke chapter number 16. In Luke chapter number 16, you read, take your Bible and look at it. You read about hell. It talks about a rich man who died and went to hell. He didn't go to hell because he was rich. A rich man got saved in Luke chapter number 19, Zacchaeus. But in Luke chapter 16, a rich man goes to hell. He goes to hell for the same reason anybody goes to hell, rich or poor. He goes to hell because he rejects the Lord Jesus Christ as his Savior. And Luke chapter 16 now, in verse number 23, it says in 22, it says the rich man died in hell. In 23, and in hell he lift up his eyes being in torments. Torments. According to the Word of God, hell, a place that you cannot see yet. One day this earth will be split open. People will be able to look right straight into hell and be able to see lost people down there in hell, half man, half something else. But be able to look at them down there as their soul's been destroyed and be able to look at them in hell. But now nobody can see that. And now people don't know exactly what it's like there outside of a Bible. And in their Bible it says, and in Hades, number one, they removed the word hell. And in Hades, Hades reminds me of a place where Brother Floyd Elmore was, near to. He was down in Honduras as a missionary for 3 years. And somewhere down in Central America, there's another little country called Haiti. Haiti. And changing, not translating the word, and just putting a transliteration in, Hades, makes you feel like, oh yeah, I wouldn't mind going there. Why, that sounds like a pretty good place to go in the wintertime, a little Caribbean cruise, and boy, we could just, you know, we could eat, drink, and be merry, and we could have a good time down in Hades. In the Bible translates a thing, hell, and says in hell he lift up his eyes, being in torments. torments. It lets you know that hell is a place of torment. And the next verse, verse number 24, it talks about him dipping the tip of his finger in water to cool my tongue, for I am in, for I'm tormented in this flame. Flame. It talks about a flame. It tells you that hell is a place of torment. In about three or four verses there in the passage, in Luke chapter 16, each time speaks of it as a place of torment, not a place to vacation, and not a place to go to sleep and sleep for a while until you get rested up, but a place of torment, anguish, that kind of a thing, and talks about a place where there's fire and somebody cries out for a drop of water to cool their tongue because they're tormented in a flame. And in the JW Bible, to them, it's kind of a thing whereby Abraham said, child, remember that thou received in full your good things in your lifetime, but Lazarus correspondingly the injurious things. Now, however, he is having comfort here, but you are in anguish. Bible says torment. And besides all these things, a great chasm has been fixed between us and you people, so that those wanting to go over from here to you people cannot, neither may people cross over from there to us. Then he said, in that event I ask you, Father, send him to the house of my father, for our five brothers, in order that he may give them a thorough witness, that they also should not get in this place of torment. And so just a very definite weakening of the place called hell. And you know, you say, well, they're just trying to remove the fear of it. And you know, you got to win people by love. Some people you win by love. And the Bible says some save with compassion, others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hitting the garments spotted by the flesh. And so there's some people that, you know, you showing all kinds of love to them, not going to do them any good. They've already been showing love. God's been merciful to them. God's been loving to them. God's been kind to them and hadn't done any good. And some people, you got to put the fear of God in them before they ever get saved. There are some people who won't get saved by compassion, but some will get saved if they get scared, plumb to death, and know that when they die, which could be at any moment, they die and go straight to hell. That'll put the fear of God in them, and they may get saved. Chance for them to get saved. Fear is a legitimate motive to witness to anybody. I mean, Jesus Christ spoke about hell a lot of places. He spoke about hell more than he spoke about heaven. And the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11, Noah, being moved with fear moved the man. He did what he did because of fear. Sometimes people get saved and just because they heard a good hot message on hell. Noah, being moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his household. Some things in between there. He condemned the world and was heirs of them, which are righteousness by faith. But anyhow, fear was the thing that moved Noah. So it's a legitimate reason to witness to somebody about going to hell and the fact they're going to go to hell and their never-dying soul is going to burn and never burn up, and they're going to be in torment and they're going to be in a flaming fire forever and forever. It's legitimate reason. But the JWs, again, they cool it down, and they just weaken the passage that deals with hell by the Lord Jesus Christ himself. And of course, they say that hell is the grave. And then when it comes to their Bibles, of course, they've got more than one way of salvation. Now, back to hell, I need to give you another portion of Scripture. Look at Mark chapter number 9, another portion that Jesus Christ spoke about hell many times. Mark chapter 9, verse 43 to 48. And the Lord Jesus Christ, about seven or eight times, he uses the word fire. The JWs have reduced the thing down to about two or three times. Here's the way it reads in a JW Bible. You follow along and watch how they air condition hell. Mark chapter 9, verse 43. If you've got a Bible with red letters in it, you know it's words of the Lord Jesus Christ. All right, it says, if your hand makes you stumble, cut it off. It is finer for you to enter into life maimed than with two hands to go off into Gehenna. Again, not coming through like Jesus Christ did into hell. All right, into Gehenna, into the fire that cannot be put out. All right, say not too bad yet. Number 44, the verse is completely out. All right, 45. And if your foot makes you stumble, cut it off. It is finer for you to enter into life lame than with 2 feet to be pitched into Gehenna. And no fire this time. And number 46, completely out. 47. And if your eye makes you stumble, throw it away. It is finer for you to enter one eye into the kingdom of God than with two eyes to be pitched into Gehenna. No fire. Where the maggots does not die and the fire is not put out. All right, now you read fire but two times in the most critical passage you find by the Lord Jesus Christ, the two most critical passages by Jesus Christ on hell are Luke chapter 16, which they weaken, and Mark chapter 9, just as hotter, and they've air-conditioned that, baby, you better believe it. All right, now count up the times you read fire in your Bible. Count them up between verse 43 and verse 48. You're looking at it how many times? Seven times? Eight times? How many times? Six times? All right, six is still a good deal more than two. If you read it six times in about five or six verses, you pretty well get the idea. When it gets talking about going into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched, where the worm dieth not and the fire is not quenched, you get the idea what it's all about. But this outfit here, they remove the torment of the hot flames of hell from a devil's hell. You can be sure they cool the thing down so that nobody is too alarmed at all. And people just take the thing as, oh, it's probably just a figurative type of a thing. It's, you know, just a parable. So it really doesn't matter all that much anyhow. It does make a difference. And for some people, those are the very verses that need put on them and the very witness you need to give to them. And they need to realize they're going to fry like a turkey if they don't get saved. And they need to know that, need to put it on them. So they weaken the passage that way. Again, in the Bibles, they give you two ways of salvation. According to the J.W. Bible, you can get saved by water baptism. And the blood of Jesus Christ, that's not all that immaterial. Not that important. It's just sort of, you know, it doesn't matter that much. All right, now looky here. Take your Bible, look at Acts chapter 8. Acts chapter 8. And look at verse number 37. A fellow wants to get baptized. That's the context, the Ethiopian eunuch. And he says, what doth hinder me to be baptized? And notice verse number 37 is the answer to that question. Here's a fellow trying to get right. He'd been up to Jerusalem. Now, Philip has a hold of the guy and dealing with him. And verse number 37, the thing is made clear that baptism is for believers only. Water baptism, he says, here's water, what doth hinder me to be baptized? He wants to get baptized in the passage there. He'd been, Philip had preached unto him a blood atonement, and Philip makes qualification that baptism is for believers only. In verse number 37, he said, if thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. Water baptism is a privilege for the believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. It has nothing to do with salvation. It's for the one who has already believed from the depths of their heart to the saving of their soul. That verse is very, very important. Okay, I'll read a J.W. Bible. A J.W. Bible goes like this. Look, this is verse 36 now, middle of the verse. Look, a body of water. What prevents me from getting baptized? 37. Zilch. Not goose egg. Nothing. There's nothing there. They have no verse number 37. 38. With that he commanded the chariot to halt, and they both went down. They both went down into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. When they had come up out of the water, Jehovah's Spirit quickly led Philip away, and the eunuch did not see him anymore, for he kept on going on his way rejoicing. The indication is a man went down in the water, came up out of the water, came up a different man than what he was, went down in the water, went on his way rejoicing. The indication of the passage out verse number 37 is that you could believe in water baptism for salvation if you didn't have verse number 37 in your Bible. And they have the thing completely, I mean lock, stock, and barrel, it's out of the text. Nothing, verse number 37. You know what they do? They revise the Bible so that light becomes darkness, and what this thing's supposed to be is a lamp under your feet and a light under your path, and here's one here that's not holy, but it's unholy, and it's not a lamp under your feet nor a light under your path. It's darkness all the way, and the light that God has for you has been shut down and turned out. Take your Bible, look at Colossians chapter 1 and verse number 14. Colossians chapter 1 and verse number 14. You and I say that redemption, forgiveness of sins is through the blood of Jesus Christ alone. These people here, you never could figure out how to get saved by these people. I'm going to let you get saved by baptism and then not tell you about the blood of Jesus Christ. It's wild, man. It's a salvation by works. It's not a salvation by the grace of God and by the blood of Jesus Christ. Colossians 1 verse 14, I'll read a J.W. Bible. It says, by means of whom we have our released by ransom, the forgiveness of our sins. Yours doesn't read that way. Yours says, in whom we have redemption, and these very, very important words, through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. So they just chop out the verses, chop out the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, and people continue living in darkness. You know why I say they're wicked? Because whenever Jesus Christ sheds his blood, they remove the blood. Listen, my friend, without the shedding of blood, there's no remission. People can't get saved without the blood of Jesus Christ. People can't get saved without faith in the blood of Jesus Christ. And when somebody takes what Jesus Christ did, suffered and bled and died and removes the blood out of salvation, my friend, that's about as wicked as anything could be. When the Savior suffered like he did and shed every drop of his precious blood and gave his life for many, and somebody removes the blood, atonement of Jesus Christ, out of a passage, that's very wicked. And so I don't think we're stretching anything at all to call them wicked witnesses. I believe that's the title they deserve. Okay, now there's something else that you'll probably be amazed about, and that is that we call them that because of the return of Jesus Christ. They speak much about the return of Jesus Christ. You say, what's wrong with that? You do too, Brother Martin. But there's worlds of difference in what they say about the return of Jesus Christ and what we say or the Bible says about the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. For example, they say the return of Jesus Christ was a long time ago. You missed. You missed the rapture. But of course, they don't talk about the rapture. They say it was a long time ago. As a matter of fact, in 1874, he returned invisibly to this earth. And they talk about his second presence and said that in 1878, that was the beginning of the end of the times of the Gentiles. Well, what do you know about that? The times of the Gentiles are not fulfilled until the end of the tribulation. As far as I can see, you and I do not have a kingdom under Jewish rulership and leadership. Gentiles are still on the throne. Rome is just about to take the full leadership as far as the Gentile dominion over this earth is concerned. And their statement is that Jesus Christ returned invisibly to this earth in 1874. And then for 40 years some things went on, and the millennium begins in 1914 and kind of steps up in 1918. Now, along those lines, they say that he returned invisibly and ever shall be that way. Of course, we make distinction between the rapture, and we make distinction between that and his second advent or his second return where he lands upon this earth. But just to show you how wild their stuff is, go to Revelation chapter 1 and verse number 7. Last book in the Bible, book of Revelation, chapter 1, verse number 7. Revelation 1, 7. They say he returned invisibly. And it ever shall be that way. The Bible says, behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him. Every eye shall see him. Description, when he comes back is found in Psalm 19. He makes a circuit of the heavens. The old time Methodist was a circuit riding preacher. The Lord Jesus Christ, he makes a circuit of the heavens. All across this earth, the Lord Jesus Christ shows up. When he comes a second time, every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. That's the truth of the matter. And John adds amen to the thing. You can count on the fact when Jesus Christ comes back, every eye is going to see him. When JWSA came invisibly the second time in 1874, you can forget what they got to say. It's a whole pack of lies from start to finish. Are the beginning and the end of the Gentiles, times of the Gentiles, 1878? That's not true. You haven't even reached the tribulation yet. And they don't end until the end of the tribulation when Jesus Christ comes back. Some more wild stuff is in 1881, Christian churches. And you'd be tossed in the so-called category of Christian churches. Christian churches have forfeited their service to the Lord Jesus Christ. 1914 is the end of the times of the Gentiles. Isn't that wild? And the millennium starts whenever this happens. And at that point in time, Jesus Christ took his throne in heaven as king. Now take your Bible and look at Luke chapter number 1. Whenever the Lord Jesus Christ comes back second time, He comes back to this earth. He comes back as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Comes back to this earth. He sets up His kingdom right here on this earth, a literal physical, visible kingdom upon the face of this earth. And look at Luke chapter 1, verse 32 and verse number 33. It doesn't sit down on the throne in heaven. He sits down on David's throne at Jerusalem on this earth. Verse number 32. It says, He shall be great and shall be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God shall give unto Him the throne of His father David. And He shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of His kingdom there shall be no end. It's a literal throne on this earth at Jerusalem, David's throne. The Lord Jesus Christ sits upon David's throne and runs the show when He comes back the second time. Now, of course, they say that, Jesus Christ took the throne then. And they say that to show you here on earth that Jesus Christ is ruling and is the king sitting on the throne in heaven, and you and I are, to an extent, in the millennium, that's been proven because of the fact that we now have, and beginning back in 1918, we have things such as motion pictures. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that tremendous? My, doesn't that prove that we're in the millennium? The motion picture industry. Boy, what a tremendous aid to the millennium. Great motion pictures. They say we're in the millennium because we now have dynamite. That's tremendous. Look what man has done with dynamite. Isn't that just great? Why, the Bible, whenever you go on the millennium, the Bible says that men take their swords and beat them into plowshares. In Isaiah chapter 2 and verse number 4, and Micah chapter 4, and verse 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. That's what the millennium's all about. Not such things as dynamite, telephones, telegraph, television. Boy, hasn't television been a blessing? You say, well, it can be. It can be. What's the devil done with it? For the most part, he's taken that which should be a blessing, and he's made a curse out of the thing. And they say because of TV and vacuum cleaners, etc. and so on, that's Judge Rutherford's list, that you and I now are, in a sense, living in the millennium. And 1918, Christ entered the symbolic temple, and He adopted the JWs. What do you know? As His official agents on earth. And you all, including this church here, we had done forfeited our service to Jesus Christ way back in 1881, and beginning in 1918, the official agents of Jesus Christ on this earth are none other than the JWs, believe it or not. Not. Absolutely not. You know what they are? They're a mess. They're a mess because they revised the Bible. They're a mess because the return of the Lord Jesus Christ has been taught as though He returned a long time ago. Now here's two important verses in your Bible. Back in the book of Timothy, look at 1 Timothy 1 and 2 Timothy 2. This is real important. 1 Timothy chapter 1, if He returned a long time ago, which He did not, you and I are in error. If He did not, and we're looking for His return, and know the tribulation shall follow, and the millennium comes after that, then they've got a great problem in saying that He returned in His second presence in 1874. Of course, His presence here upon the earth that never has diminished. He said, when I go away, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit of God. So in that, along those lines, God still has a witness here. But 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse number 20. It talks about somebody who made faith shipwreck in verse 19. Look at 20. Of whom is Hymenaeus? He names names. Ooh, how rude. Of whom is Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I have delivered unto Satan. Somebody turned over to Satan, that they may learn not to blaspheme. What did they do? Look at 2 Timothy chapter 2. Just come on back a couple of pages. 2 Timothy chapter number 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2, look at verse number 18, or 17. And their word will eat as doth a canker, of whom is Hymenaeus. The Lord seems to name names. Somebody gets rotten enough, He names names. Somebody's so bad, He delivered him over to Satan. And what was the problem? They destroyed somebody's faith. What did they do? 18 describes it. Who concerning the truth have erred, saying that the resurrection is past already, and overthrow the faith of some. If the second coming of Jesus Christ is a thing of the past, then something's wrong with what I teach you, and the resurrection, you all have missed it. I'm talking about Jesus Christ taking some people out of the graves. I'm talking about a resurrection in the future. I go out to the grave sites whenever I have memorial service for somebody. If they're saved, I tell to that family, the dead shall be raised incorruptible. And this body that we put to rest in this grave here will be raised one day when the Lord Jesus Christ comes back. Listen, my friend, either what I teach is very wicked, or what they teach is the extreme of wickedness. Say not the resurrection is past already and Jesus Christ has already come. A book called The Harp of God, page 172. The bodies in which Jesus appeared after his resurrection were neither the body that was crucified nor his glorious spiritual body, but bodies. What is this stuff? Bodies. Plural. The bodies in which he appeared after his resurrection were neither the body that was crucified, nor his glorious spiritual body, but bodies created expressly for the purpose of appearing unto his disciples. Our Lord's human body, the one crucified, was removed from the tomb by the power of God. The scriptures do not reveal what became of the body, except it did not corrupt. That's true. That's because he didn't stay down long enough. 3 days and three nights up he comes. Lazarus was dead 4 days. Behold, he stinketh. We can only surmise that the Lord may have preserved it somewhere to exhibit to the people in the millennial age, and it's as though the Lord Jesus Christ did not come up. Like he said, handle me and see, for a spirit hath not flesh and bones as you see me have. He came up, God gave him some kind of a different body, but it was not the body that went into the grave. My friend, listen, that's very deceitful. If the body that went into the grave was not the body that came out of the grave alive, then there is no resurrection. If Jesus Christ did not come out, if that body that went in did not come out, then the Bible says you and I are of all men most miserable. There's nobody more miserable than you and I, because it says there's no resurrection of the dead. It's that simple. If Jesus Christ didn't come up, then you're in your sins, I'm in my sins, and there is no resurrection. And a very deceitful thing that they teach, that he did not come out in the body that he went in with. It was the same body, it just was a glorified body. Take your Bible, look at the Gospel of John. Now in chapter 20, look at verse number 25. Gospel of John, chapter 20. Look at verse number 25. Thomas was a very doubtful man. And Thomas says in verse number 25 to the other disciples, they said they'd seen the Lord. Middle of the verse, but he said unto them, except I shall see in the hands the print of the nails, and put my finger into the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe. In plainer words, that body that went in that was nail-scarred, had holes in the hands, had a hole that was pierced in the side, that body that went in, Tom said, if I don't see that body, I will not believe. You can talk all day and all night, you can tell me what you want to tell me, I will not believe. 27. Then saith he to Thomas, reach hither thy finger, and behold my hands. And reach hither thy hand, and thrust it into my side, and be not faithless, but believing. And Thomas answered and said unto him, my Lord and my God. You know what it was? Thomas became a believer. Thomas realized that body that went in is the body that came out. Why? Because of the holes in the hands and the hole in the side. He realized the same body that went in came out of the grave. In heaven they believe that. Take your Bible and look at Revelation chapter 5 and verse number 6. Revelation 5 and verse number 6. It says, and I beheld, lo, in the midst of the throne, this puts you in heaven now, and the four beasts in the, says, and in the midst of the elders stood a lamb as it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes. All right, now looky here. A lamb as it had been slain. Evidently, it had to be the same body. It'd be the same type of thing as what you have Whenever it comes to the Lord Jesus Christ, like Thomas wanted to see whether or not it's the same body, I want to see some nail prints in those hands. I want to see the hole in his side. And you know, later on, Zechariah, the Bible speaks about a bunch of people asking questions. It'll be a picture of the millennium. And what are these wounds in thine hands? And he says, those with which I was wounded in the house of my friends. And I'm telling you something. The Lord Jesus Christ's body that went in, that same body came out. It came out a glorified body. But it was the same body. And the Bible says in Acts chapter number 1, verse number 11, that same body went back to heaven after he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs. And to Thomas, there was no question, he saw the nail prints in his hands and he saw the hole in his side. Very wicked thing that they do, destroying deceitfully the bodily resurrection of your loved ones when they do it to the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Another statement in a book that they put out and published called The Truth Shall Make You Free, page 264. Since witnesses teach the non-existence of an immaterial soul after death, and the Christ's material body was not raised, we can only conclude that Christ experienced annihilation when he died. They say, Jehovah God disposed of that body in his own way. Annihilation? That's about the way they teach things. Just as he disposed of the body of Moses, but no one knows how. A bunch of lost people living in complete black darkness. The Bible tells you that he did come back, and you have to a carnal church, the longest chapter written and given unto them, the church at Corinth, you have 58 verses dealing with the resurrection, the literal, actual, bodily resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ himself. And the body that went in is the body that came out. And that resurrection of Jesus Christ guarantees to you and I and all the dying Christ Jesus a bodily resurrection from the grave as well. Another thing that the wicked Jehovah Witnesses do is they reject the Bible hell spoken of by the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I read to you from their Bible, so you pretty well know what I say is so. But as well as air conditioning the passages on hell, they say that hell is not a bottomless pit and a lake of fire in the heart of the earth. They say it's the grave. And that it's not a place of torment, it's a place of rest. Believe it or not, a man by the name of Milton, the last name's Henschel, answered some questions for a fellow that was dealing, wrote a book called Religions in America. And on page 61 of the book, they asked this Jehovah Witness, so this is his answer, as a leading man of the Jehovah Witness movement, what do the witnesses believe about hell? Henschel's answer, member, big, top dog, J.W., here's his answer per se. Hell is the grave. It is not a place of fiery eternal torment. Hell is a place of rest. So out in the world, you know, whenever somebody gets aggravated at another person, says, I'll go to hell. They got it all wrong. You know what they're doing according to J.W. teaching? They're taking somebody that's done them wrong or somebody they're aggravated at, mad at, an enemy, and they're really bidding them Godspeed. Ah, go to a place of rest. Isn't that wild? But of course, it's not a place of rest. It's just like the Lord Jesus Christ said. The further statement goes this way. A place of rest and hope of resurrection, which is very deceitful anyhow, after what they teach about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. In hope of resurrection, not a place of torture from which one can never escape. Peter said Jesus was in hell after his death. Of course, they reject the distinction of a body and soul being different. So when it says his soul was not left in hell, They cannot believe that it was like the Bible says. The grave, tomb of Joseph of Arimathea, the soul in hell, spirit back to the Father. And they say death and hell will be destroyed at the end of the 1,000-year rule of Christ. The Bible doesn't say that. It doesn't say it'll be destroyed. It says death and hell will be cast into the lake of fire. It's like the old saying, oh, the frying pan of the fire. That's exactly how it goes. Their argument is that, you know, the Bible, you know, we call hell, and the Bible, it's really ought to be Hades and Gehenna. Of course, our argument is that 1611 A.D. has further light than any Greek text, and shows to you that whether it's Hades or Gehenna, hell is still a place of fire. In Luke chapter 16, he talks about the flame. I'm tormented in this flame. In Luke chapter, Mark chapter number 9, where they say it should be Gehenna, Jesus Christ over and over speaks about fire. And their answer is those passages, and especially Luke chapter 16, that's a parable. But you know from the Bible that a fire is fire, even in a parable. If you don't know, take your Bible, look at Matthew. Go to Matthew chapter 13, look at verse number 30. This is a parable and said to be such. Not everything Jesus Christ said was a parable, though many times he spoke to them in parables, yet not all the time was it a parable. A Jehovah's Witness thinks that everything he said was a parable. How silly. All right, now, take your Bible and look at Matthew 13, verse number 30. Chapter 13 and verse number 30. In a parable now. He says, let both grow together into the harvest, and in the time of harvest I will say to the reapers, gather ye together first the tares, and bind them in bundles to burn them. Well, probably figurative to them. But gather the wheat into my barn. But when Jesus Christ interprets the parable, notice the interpretation begins in verse number 37. He that soweth a good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world. And on down the line interpretation comes. 39, the enemy that sowed them is the devil. But 40, watch how it goes with fire. As therefore the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so shall it be in the end of this world. Look at 42. 41, I better get it both. The Son of Man shall send forth his angels, and they shall gather out of his kingdom all things that offend them which do iniquity, and shall cast them into a furnace of fire. There shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. In a parable which you have in Matthew chapter 13, when the burning is interpreted, it's interpreted in verse number 40 and verse number 42 as being fire, exactly like you find in the parable. Fire is still fire, even in a parable, and the J.W. teaching on hell being the grave or being a place of rest has to be false, because there's no fire nor sign of fire, not even in any grave that you have ever seen opened up. None whatsoever. And hell is not the grave, like they say, and hell is not a place, like they say, but hell is a lake of fire, like Jesus said, and hell is a place of eternal torment, just like Jesus said. They reject the Bible hell spoken of by the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Another reason why I say they're wicked is because they say the book of Revelation is not literal. That's a very wicked thing to do. Others do it as well, such as amillennialists. You must remember that you don't just say part of it's not literal and the other part is. Some say that Revelation 20, like the all mills, they say that no millennium. Revelation 20 is spiritual. If Revelation 20 is spiritual, then Revelation 19 is spiritual. No second coming. If Revelation 19 is spiritual, then he doesn't actually come back to this earth. And Revelation 1:7, that's spiritual, and then J.W. may have it right. Maybe it's just an invisible second presence. Took place in 1874. Unless it's literal like the Bible says, every eye shall see him. But I say it's wicked because you take away the second coming of Jesus Christ. You take away the 1,000-year reign of Jesus Christ. You take away
heaven or the New Jerusalem as well from the book of Revelation, when you say that a book of Revelation is just spiritual, not literal. Now, what they do is a very slick trick. You could expect it. What do the witnesses believe about heaven? They asked Mr. Henschel. He said, heaven is a habitation of spirit creatures. It's a place of God's throne. The reward of spiritual life works with Christ Jesus in heaven. For men on earth is limited to those who inherit the kingdom of God. Ooh, can't get the distinction between heaven and the millennial inheritance on earth. In Revelation 7:4, this number is given as exactly 144,000. All right, take your Bible, look at the book of Revelation. It's real important. Revelation chapter 7, look at verse number 4. They say in heaven there's only going to be 144,000 people. And they say that they are the 144,000. Revelation chapter 7, look at verse number 4. And I heard the number of them which were sealed, and they were sealed in 144,000. They got it right there with as far as the number of all the tribes of the children of, Israel. JWs are, for the most part, the Gentiles. Not too many Jews have been taken in with the JW movement. Heaps of them are black folk, but the passage says the 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel. Israel. Not black folk, not Gentiles. They say, oh, well, you got to spiritualize the thing. Spiritual Jews. All right, now look. There's such a thing as a spiritual Jew. Romans chapter 2, last couple of verses in the chapter, 28 and 29. There's such a thing as the physical Jew. There's the spiritual Jew, there is the literal Jew. They say just a spiritual passage. Now, that be true. Why would you say that that part of the verse is spiritual? The Israel side. We're spiritual Jews. And doesn't really mean the house of Israel. If that's spiritual, then what about the 144,000? Isn't it wild to say that in one verse, part of the verse is literal. 144,000 is the exact number destined to heaven. And the rest of the verse is spiritual. We can just throw it out and do what we want to do with it. And on top of that, to show you how the Lord plays tricks on someone like that, with that being a major doctrine, look at verse number 9. Same chapter, verse number 9. After this I beheld no great multitude which no man could number. Which no man could number? Well, I can count to 144,000. I may not know trigonometry and calculus and some of the stuff that some guys know, but I can count to 144,000. Why about anybody here count to 144,000? That wouldn't be all that hard. All right, which no man could number of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands. You're dealing with a scene that takes place in heaven, and it's not just spiritual Jews, or it is spiritual Jews, and of course it deals with literal Jews, the tribulation as well, but deals with spiritual Jews from every nation, not JW. Not JWs, my friend, but saved people that have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Verse number 14, the blood they don't even believe in, not water, but the blood of the Lamb. And God just has destroyed everything they've got going in one chapter. Revelation 7, verse 4, they're wiped out. Verse number 9, they're wiped out. Verse number 14, they are wiped out, my friend. Listen, you can believe the Bible and you can believe the book of Revelation exactly as it stands. Their statement goes on like this. In a book called The Harp of God, there will not be a great number of this bride class. On the contrary, they are small in number. Jesus said they'd be but a little flock. Quote Luke 12. Of course, that's physical, literal Israel. Luke 12. That has to do with a very small remnant that's left at the end of the tribulation. Does not have to do with the body of Christ. He says, so the Apostle John, through the Apostle John, he designates the number as 144,000. Wrong. through the Apostle John. He speaks about 144,000 sealed on this earth in the tribulation, raptured out, middle of the tribulation, Revelation chapter 14, but from nations, a bunch, the Bible says, no man could number. Another man says 144,000, and he quotes from Let God Be True, and I need to close up here, can't quite get it in. So since the minor cult, Christadelphians, will be short, I guess I'll have to finish next time. But to finish out the material in the 144,000, the statements go like that: the 144,000 share the heavenly glory and the rest on earth. When you talk to the JWs, they say, you going to heaven? They say no. Strange that those people have no hope of going to heaven. Paul said, absent from the body, present with the Lord. Paul talks about those coming with Jesus Christ. He's in heaven now. Evidently, they're there. Whenever the rapture takes place, God's going to bring them with Him. There'll be a reunion in the air. And yet these people say they have no hope of heaven. You and I speak about the blessed hope. But anyhow, the 144,000 are discovered to be such as live a holy life, separate from this world, and serve God henceforth to eternity. That's found in one of their publications called Make Sure of All Things, page 91. Again, they say after baptism, such a dedicated one is justified after baptism, then sanctified or set apart for faithful preaching of Christ's kingdom till death. If he's faithful to death, such will be granted immortality, because having shown himself worthy of a perfect life on earth, this he proceeds to sacrifice, as Jesus had done, thus obtaining the right to heavenly life with Christ after death. And said that you don't have to be perfect to obtain the coming earthly paradise, but you have to be perfect, holy, sanctified, and on the thing goes, from this time henceforth and forevermore, to attain heaven. And there is a sense in which it's true. We're perfect in that we have the perfect righteousness of Jesus Christ given to us. We're perfect in our standing before God because we stand perfect, clothed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. But we are not perfect because we live a holy, separate life from this time henceforth and are found faithful unto death. We are perfect because knowing we're no good, and knowing that we couldn't attain anything, and knowing we can't even attain goals that we shoot for many times as a Christian, we feel like, Paul, I have not attained, and sometimes we feel like we've been a complete flop. Knowing that we're no good, thank God we've come to Jesus Christ, and we've received the righteousness of Jesus Christ as a free gift, and therefore we stand complete in Him, and we stand perfect in the eyes of God, and we stand perfect because of the perfect sinless righteousness of Jesus Christ, not because of one thing we've ever done ourselves to attain glory, but we stand complete in Jesus Christ, our Savior. And I say that this bunch of people is a wicked bunch of people, because they take the book of Revelation that reveals some things to you. Why, the thing says it's the revelation of Jesus Christ and reveals to you Jesus Christ, God manifest in the flesh, reveals to you Jesus Christ, who one day will come back as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, reveals to you that one day there will be a resurrection, reveals to you a millennial reign on this earth, reveals to you a new Jerusalem come down from God out of heaven, reveals to you things that you need to know, and they say those things are Mickey Mouse stories, those things are bedtime stories, those things are not literal, but those things are just spiritual, and then they make you feel good, but those things are not the truth of the matter. And they put that out in publications like Let God Be True. How deceptive, wicked, and ungodly. And in the Bible it says, yea, let God be true, and every man a liar. They are wicked witnesses, they are liars, they are lost in their sins, they reject the blood atonement of Jesus Christ, they have a form of works for salvation, if there is such a thing, they don't even have hope themselves of going to heaven, and a wicked bunch of people lost and going to hell, thinking they're going to the grave and they're going to rest when they're going to the fire and going to spend eternity in torment forevermore. What do? We have a jump on them. The material I gave to you tonight, some of them don't even know themselves. Know what they believe. Have answers of the hope that lies within you with meekness and fear. Dump the Word of God on them. Hold them to the Word of God. When they say it's spiritual, say, wait a minute, man. If that thing dealing with Israel is spiritual, then why do I worry about 144,000? Why would I not say that the number is spiritual as well? I mean, catch them in their own trap. Take how God traps them. Give them verse number 9. Give them verse number 14. And show them from the Word of God they're lost and going to hell. But do your best to try to win them to the Lord Jesus Christ Himself. Down south of town was the only bunch that ever I've accomplished much with. And these people here, one time when I was teaching this material, we went down to see them, and the questions began to be asked. What about this? What about that? And of course, things being fresh in my mind, I had answers. And they pulled out of the movement. They now witness to them. They've become outstanding Christians. They're connected with the Bible-believing church. They even pay the price to go and travel 30 miles one way to go to a Bible-believing church of about 10 to 15 people. And perhaps if you do your best to try to win someone like that that comes to your doorstep and you try to show them how wicked the movement really is, maybe you'll get one that'll be just as good or better as well. You won't win a lot. I haven't had much success. But there's a chance you might win one. There's a chance you might, by all means, save some or more than one. But I'm loading you down. I'm arming you so you are never, never deceived. And so you know what they perhaps don't even know themselves. And so you know about the movement, how wicked it really is. And so you can witness to them. And you can be Jehovah's witnesses to the ungodly, wicked witnesses that come to your door. May God help you to do that. May God make the material real to you. May God bring scriptures back to your remembrance. May God help you as you witness to the strongest movement of cults that we have in our country, the ungodly movement called the Jehovah's Witnesses. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Our Father, we thank you now for the Word of God. We do ask you, Lord, to give help. And may the Holy Spirit of God help these Christians retain some of this material. Lord, may they be loaded down and armed. May they not be afraid of these people. May these people, after talking to some of our church family, may they be afraid of us. Help these Christians never be afraid of them. Help them to have the Word of God at their command. Help them to work on the material. Help them to get things worked out and be able to deal with them from the Word of God. God forbid that anyone here should ever be twisted and deceptively used and maligned by this group of people. It's our prayer, and we ask in the name of Jesus Christ with thanksgiving. Amen. Jesus. And that's a favorite Campbellite song after they get baptized. They sing that song, "Now I Belong to Jesus." And that's a good song. We just can't quit singing it because they sing it for that reason, wrong reason. But you and I, whenever we get saved, washed in the blood of Jesus Christ, you belong to Jesus Christ. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, you're not your own, you're bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and your spirit, which are His. You're not your own, you're bought with a price. And so I like to, I guess like the pros do, we'll kind of lighten it up before a bunch of dead material. We'll just kind of go and have a good time. And I like for about two or three testimonies as to your conversion, you know, when you now belong to Jesus. And if you want to give a water baptism testimony, then you'll probably get booed out of the place, but you can try it. But if you have a clear-cut testimony,
Why don't you stand and give a testimony as to when you got saved and your conversion experience? I watched Dr. Ruckman for a lot of years, and I remember one time he came down to Baptist Temple. I knew the material he was teaching was real heavy stuff, and I watched how he did it. And what he did, he told some stories before he went into it, and then he went into it and just went through the heavy material just as fast as he could, and then he come out the other side and told another couple of stories and lighted the thing back up and then went on his way. So I'm going to try and do it like the pros. You tell a couple of, tell your conversion experience, and I'll go into this real dry, dusty material, fast as I can, talk as fast as I can, and then I'll come out the other side and let you give a couple more testimonies, about 9 o'clock. No, how about just a couple of them to start with? If you're saved and you know it, say amen. Man, I ought to get two or three testimonies out of that. Lianne, amen. Amen.
And when I was going, it was however 2 weeks. And the first week, I just thought it was real nice to go and loved it. The second week, I really didn't get convicted.
Amen.
I always give my heart to the Lord. I knew at that time that I was a sinner, but I still wouldn't do it. And then that following Sunday morning, the pastor was preaching a sermon, and I got so convicted that I went down front that Sunday morning. And I think Bible school is wonderful, and it does bring, I was 12 years old when I was saved, and I don't think I know I'll never regret that.
Amen, amen, glory to God, amen. Okay, somebody else, you saved and you know it, tell us when you got saved. Ron?
Since it's a Bible school,
okay. Amen. Amen. Glory to God. Okay. Anybody else want to testify? Bruce?
Well, when I was little, I supposedly got saved 3 times.
That's right. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Okay, now that's the real thing, see? That's just testimony of salvation by the grace of God. Praise the Lord for that, man. That's just great. And what we're going to be dealing with tonight is something, if you was in a JW church or a Christadelphian church for 25 years, you never hear any testimonies like you heard tonight. You never get your heart blessed that way. Never get your spirit lifted. Never get a refreshing to your soul like you got tonight. It's not there.
I mean, the leaders of the movement, Russell, died, and he never had a testimony all those years. 1916, that'll be 16 years. He began the movement about 20 years before, and 35 years or better, you think that fellow would have some kind of a testimony. And that fellow lived and died without a testimony of salvation by the grace of God. Didn't have any joy in his heart, died without joy, and naturally so. I never had no joy until I got saved. It all comes with salvation. And so this stuff here now, it's just information for you, and it's information that you need. And if it's real dry to you, the driest, I'll tell you the people that's the driest of all too, that's the people who never witnessed for the Lord Jesus Christ. If all you have is just to listen to what I've got to say, then it's going to be just, it'll be drier than last week. But if you do something with what I put to you, and if you witness, you're going to run across these people before too awful long, and the material will suddenly come alive. And your memory and your recall capabilities all of a sudden is going to be straining to try to remember the material and try to remember, oh yes, Brother Martin said something about that. What's the answer to that? And so this material is not just tossed out just foolishly, but this is material that you need to have, and it's material now that we've been dealing with for a month or two, and it's on the major calls, completing the work on Jehovah's Witnesses. Now this bunch of people, just for a brief summation now, a brief going back over review of what we've studied up to this point, we call them the Wicked Witnesses because they've taken a name. They've taken the name Jehovah God of the Old Testament, being Jesus Christ of the New Testament, and I showed you why. And they've taken and done anything but be a witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. They have lowered the Lord Jesus Christ even below the level of the devil. And if you witness to them, you'll find that to be true. John found to be true the other night, witnessing to the Jehovah Witness lady. And so we consider that to be a very wicked thing, and therefore we believe a better name, not Jehovah's Witnesses, but a better name, a more proper name, would be the Wicked Witnesses. They are witnesses, but they're wicked people to do that. We talked about Arianism, where the roots were clear back in 260 to 325 A.D., and how that in 381 A.D. they thought they had it wiped out, but they evidently did not. And years later, a fellow by the name of Charles Taz Russell resurrected the movement of Arianism, and it began what is known as the Jehovah Witness movement. I talked to you about the roots. I talked to you about the result of Razzmatazz Russell, which was the J.W. movement, the record of deception, and how they changed the names and how they played games with the Negro folk. I talked to you about how they reduced Jesus Christ to the level of the devil, and that ought to be enough to make you feel like I do. They're very wicked people. I talked to you about how they revised the Bible so that light becomes darkness. The Bible is supposed to bring light to you. They mess with it until it's just a book of darkness, the one that they have. I talked to you about the return of the Lord Jesus Christ, supposedly was invisible, 1914. Talked to you about that. Talked to you about the resurrection of Jesus and how that they say it's not like the Bible says. And that when he came back, he didn't have the body he went in with that was glorified, but he came back and he had different bodies they talk about. They nullify the resurrection. If there be no resurrection, you and I are of all men most miserable. They reject the Bible hell, the Lord Jesus Christ, and they say the grave is a place of rest. Phenomenal. I mean, it's wild. A place of rest. You can't believe it, but I read the words to you from those folk themselves. Last thing that we studied last time was the book of Revelation not being literal. Now, they talk about the kingdom. They talk about the millennial reign of the Lord Jesus Christ as being a 1,000-year reign. And some things they take to be literal, and some they say are spiritual. They say, whenever you're dealing with the 12 tribes, that's the spiritual Jews, and we are the spiritual Jews. And they say that they are the spiritual Jews there. Of course, lost people are not spiritual Jews. Saved people are, but of course, they are not. And they say that the 144,000 are the ones that are going to be going to heaven. And they say that that's part of their group there. I read here in the Christadelphians, who are junior JWs, I read some figures there where, and this book doesn't look all that old, they had this point in time, probably about, see, publication here, no date. It looks like a rather late book,
Anyhow, in this book here, it says at this point, whenever they published their figures here, they only had, J.W. has only claimed to have had 10,000 and some odd number there of people who are part of the 144,000. They've only had 10,000 have passed on to heaven, being part of the 144,000. That being true, we'd be a long time down the road before that 144,000 ever is completed. So anyhow, that's some of the foolishness that you have with the JWs. And we talked about how that even in the verse itself, it talks about Jews being sealed and 144,000. And you don't spiritualize half of the verse and say the other part is literal like they do. Pretty much it'd have to be insane thinking. Revelation chapter 7, verse number 9, talks about a number, a bunch of people that are redeemed that no man could number. And then in Revelation chapter 7 again, in verse number 14, it talks about a bunch of people who were had their robes made white and washed in the blood of the Lamb. Now, one more thing with JWs, and we sum it up, and that be in a sense a review and a summation. And another thing they're known for is that they refuse to salute the flag or serve their country. Refuse to salute the flag or serve their country. They say that just in the saluting of the flag that we are worshiping what they would consider equal to a graven image. And the words of the JWs themselves are that any national flag is a symbol of sovereign power regarded by the people as sacred. We believe in the powers that be being ordained of God, Romans chapter number 13. I don't believe that those powers at this point in time is anything sacred about them. I believe those men, if they had listened to the Lord, I believe they could do the very things and lead the country exactly the way the Lord would want that country led. But of course they don't. We don't believe that they're sacred, don't believe that the flag is sacred as such. It is the emblem of our nation. The JWs cannot participate in an act that ascribes salvation to the national emblem. Don't know where they got that from. Evidently they're implying that people, because they salute this flag, have a belief in salvation along the lines of America and to the nation for which it stands. They refuse to salute the flag. I read an article not long ago about a bunch of ball players and how those ball players, professional ball players on TV, before the ball game, some of those guys just stand around and talk. They won't even give so much as honor to our country when the national anthem is being played. They just go over and chit-chat for a while, and they won't even stand there with their helmet upon their heart and give respect to the flag as the national anthem is sung. Those guys ought to be tossed out. If the country's not good enough for them to be known as Americans, why don't they go to Japan and play the ball? Why don't they go to Africa and play the ball? Why don't they go somewhere else and play the ball? And draw the salaries over there. Why draw American dollars where the big bucks are at? And some of that stuff sort of gets upsetting at times. Same thing goes for JWs. They refuse to salute the flag, and they refuse to serve their country fighting in wars. And they quote the verse, one of the Ten Commandments, where the Bible says, "Thou shalt not kill." Now take your Bible, look at Matthew chapter 19, and let's settle that thing once and for all. Matthew chapter 19, these people have their heads stuck in the sand. They're willfully ignorant. Matthew chapter 19, all the time they spend in Matthew, which is a kingdom book, you'd think that somewhere along the line they'd get as far as chapter 19 and read verse number 18. Matthew chapter 19 and verse number 18. The Lord Jesus Christ comes down the list here, talking about the Ten Commandments. And when he gets to the commandment that says, "Thou shalt not kill," he interprets that commandment, everything else being the same, needing no interpretation. And the one that apparently needs help is, "Thou shalt not kill." I mean, for example, I was in a restaurant today and I saw a fly. Do you think I, put something out here and said, "Come on over here, little bitty fly. I sure feel sorry for you. Look hungry. Why don't you just land on my chicken here?" No, I mean, I went like this, and I went like this, and I went like this. And I felt like, just land one more time. I'm going to get you. Just one more time. I don't care if I knock that sugar bowl halfway across the room. I'm going to get that fly. Well, the Bible says, "Thou shalt not kill." You know, I mean, sometime you got to stop and think. And common sense will help you a long ways. Matthew chapter 19 and verse 18, "To settle it forevermore, the words of the Lord Jesus Christ, he saith unto him, which..." Jesus said, "Thou shalt do no murder."
All the commandments come right down the line. Here's one where they need help. Thou shalt do no murder. There's a distinction in the Bible between somebody defending their country and their nation and somebody who, with hatred in their heart, lies in wait and has determined that I'm going to get that person. If it's the last thing I do, I'm going to have their head, and goes on and kills that person. In the Bible, Deuteronomy chapter 19, that's identified as murder. And Jesus Christ identifies and puts the thing right down in black and white. Thou shalt do no murder. God has that thing down so you can't possibly miss it. So their reasons for refusing to salute the flag, identifying, connecting with the graven image, wrong. And thou shalt not kill, so they won't serve their country, wrong. Thou shalt do no murder, that's how she goes, according to Jesus Christ himself. Their statement is, wars today are not the same as Israel's wars in ancient times, because they were fighting God's wars. It was a national thing, nation against nation, and today you have the same type of thing. Well, the result is, these people go off to the ping pong camps. Well, that's what they do in the camps they go to that are called prisons. They're called federal prisons, and these people that refuse and say that I just will not go, I have objections to that kind of a thing, and I don't believe in killing anybody, and so they send them off to prison, and they serve their time in a prison, and for 3 years, while your sons and your daughters, or your sons are serving your armed forces, those guys are out there, you know, trying to get their smash perfected, and trying to learn how to really drive that thing down somebody's throat, and spend all their time playing ping pong. Yes, I know what I'm talking about. And don't act like I don't. I have run into people like that. I've known people like that. And I know from whereof I speak. And so some of that stuff is pretty ridiculous. That is the wicked movement known as Jehovah's Witnesses. Now, in closing, they are a reliable bunch of people, but they are wicked. That is, they will witness. Along certain lines, they're probably more reliable than 90% of this church right here. And if you take this church and compare it with other churches, you can imagine, yes, we do that. But many times they automatically think they've got you when they make that statement. And they are witnesses, but they're wicked witnesses. And, you know, they do go out house to house. Question is, do you? And someday they're going to come knocking on your door. And said they came knocking on her door about a couple of weeks ago. And when she told them what church that she went to, they left. But that won't happen often. I mean, she was fortunate. Somebody probably had been dealt with rather recently. And so whenever she said Bible Believers Baptist Church, that was enough. They kind of moved on. But that won't happen too often. And most of the time, they'll carry the ball as far as you allow them to carry it. As well as that, they go to the street corners and do some witnessing there. Now, I've never seen them. They've contended with me on the street corners. Maybe that's what they call street preaching. I don't know. But I've never seen them get up and actually do any preaching on the street corners. But their thinking is this. Many people cannot be reached at their residences. And so they believe they must preach to this generation before it passes away. Matthew 24. A little bit kind of messed up. And use every possible means of doing it. There's right here. Preaching on the streets is one way to do that. They're right. They've got that much right. But the doctrine and the teaching of the movement is that of somebody who's lost, ignorant, willfully ignorant. They're wicked witnesses, and they will one day wilt. You say, how's that? Matthew chapter 10 and verse number 28. The Bible says, fear not him that's able to destroy your body, but fear him that's able to destroy both body and soul in hell. Yea, I say unto you, fear him. You know how a soul's destroyed? See, I thought it wasn't annihilated. You know how it's destroyed? The shape is destroyed. And it goes from the shape of what a person is this day, it goes to the shape of perhaps a worm, where the worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. And so they're going to wilt. And it's not going to be evolution, it's going to be de-evolution. It's going to be devolution is what it's going to be. And they're going to wilt and they're going to wail. In Matthew chapter 13 and verse number 42, Jesus Christ said, as far as lost people, there shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. And according to their own testimony, a bunch of lost people.
There'll probably be lots of weeping going on amongst a bunch of those people that don't believe in hell. The Bible says there's weeping and wailing. People, you know, throwing sackcloth on their head when they saw Babylon going down and the smoke of her burning. They saw that, and the Bible says a bunch of weeping and wailing going on. And so like the Bible says, the wicked shall be turned into hell, and all the nations that forget God. And those people, according to their own testimony, have the testimony of no more than a lost person who has a form of godliness, denies the power thereof, has somebody who just has a religion and not salvation, and according to the Word of God, judging them out of their own mouth. Now, you know, when I talk this way, people get upset. And people say, you're judging. No, I'm just passing judgment based upon their own mouth. And you know, the stuff that I've given to you, I've read right out of their own material. And these people here, according to their own mouth, are judged as lost people and wicked witnesses. Take your Bible, look at Matthew, Luke chapter 19, and that's the way you judge sometimes. Jesus judged that way. Luke chapter 19, look at verse number, well, let's see the verse here. Verse number 21, Luke 19, 21. The wicked servant said to Jesus Christ, for I fear thee, because thou art an austere man. Saying Jesus Christ is like a hard man, a hard taskmaster. Thou takest up that thou layest not down, reapest that thou didst not sow. And he saith unto him, Jesus said to the wicked servant, out of thine own mouth will I judge thee, thou wicked servant. Thou knewest that I was an austere man, taking up that I laid not down, reaping that I did not sow. And the Lord Jesus Christ says, okay, I'm going to just go on and be just like you said I am. And went on and dealt with the wicked servant in a very hard, straightforward manner. And so measuring these people by their own mouths, you would have to say that they are a lost bunch of people. Just over top of everything, you would say that they're known for saying only 144,000 go to heaven, which is a contradiction. Their idea is in contradiction to Revelation chapter 7 and verse number 9, where it says there's a bunch there of which no man could number. They say that Jesus Christ is a God. The devil is a God too. They lower him from God, manifest in the flesh, down to the level of just a supernatural being like the devil himself. They, of course, deny the Trinity. They are known for that. Though the Bible in 1 John chapter 5 and verse number 7 says, in relation to Jesus Christ and the Godhead, that these three are one. And though the manuscript evidence is late along that passage, along the lines of that passage, and the fragments they found are not real early fragments, the verse had to be back there somewhere because the old-time preachers were preaching the verse as early as 200 A.D., they're known as well for saying that hell is not a lake of fire, like Jesus Christ said it is, but it's the common grave of all men. And when you talk to them, they'll say that's what the word Hades means, just the common grave of all men. And you and I know that to be wrong because fire, even in a parable, is fire. And you and I know that whenever they talk about Sheol, Sheol does deal with everything inside the heart of the earth. And you know from the Word of God that inside the earth there are parts. Or you and I would say compartments. Like the Bible says paradise, and like the Bible says hell and hellfire. Take your Bible and look at Ephesians chapter 4 and verse number 9. Ephesians 4 and verse number 9. Ephesians 4, verse 9. There are compartments in the heart of the earth. And you did have Abraham's bosom there. You did have paradise there. You also had hell there, just like Jesus Christ said. All right, the Bible says his soul was not left in hell. He went down to hell and dumped your sins right where they belong, in hell. In Ephesians chapter 4, and verse number 8, says, wherefore, he said, when he ascended upon high, led captivity captive, and gave gifts unto men. But look at verse 9. Now he that ascended, what is it but that he also descended first? Before he went up, he went down. Descended first into the lower parts of the earth. There are parts down there. And the J.W. doesn't have sense enough to read the Bible and find out what the Bible says about it. As far as the JWs, they're known for saying that Jesus Christ's return was an invisible return, and he returned already in 1914. And you and I, in a sense, are dealing with the kingdom now along the lines of telephones, telegraph, television, and telewoman. Oops, slips. And they're known as well by, scratch that, ladies, please. I'm still your friend. I don't really hate you. I just couldn't resist that. Salvation by works and water baptism, in contrast to the Bible, where redemption is through his blood and through his blood alone. They're known for no blood transfusions, and they grab the Old Testament verses like Leviticus 17 verse 10, Leviticus chapter 3 and verse number 17, verses like that that say you're not supposed to eat blood, and they say that when somebody gets blood blood transfusion, it's like unto eating blood, and of course that not being true. But those are some of the things that they're known for. You and I conclude that they're lost. You and I conclude in judging them by their own mouth that they're a bunch of wicked people and lost and going to hell and going to fry and burn in hell fire, just like Jesus said, whether they believe it or not, it's still true and still a fact. So that's kind of it as far as the JWs. They're the better known one of the four majors. Mormons probably being second, Seventh-day Adventists third. Christian Science are so chicken-hearted and hung up on love they couldn't talk to anybody. But anyhow, those are the majors. Now the next one, maybe we can cover tonight, is what we call minor cult. And there are heaps of them. There are bunches of them. And since the majors themselves haven't hardly even been interesting, been hard to really get too interested in them, you can be sure the minors are not really all that exciting either. And so we'll just take one of these, and this bunch is called the Christadelphians. Christadelphians. Now, you say, is anything like Philadelphians? Yeah, probably a lot of lost people over there. Mike's trying to win them, but probably hadn't got them all. Probably hadn't got the town converted yet. He's probably still weeping over, oh, Philadelphia, Philadelphia, you're a mess. But anyhow, Philadelphia meaning phileo, meaning love, and adelphos, man or brother, from whence we say Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love. Would you like to live there? Aren't you glad the Lord called Mike Collingwood to that territory? I am. You know, wouldn't you like to just live right downtown the heart of that city of brotherly love? About the time the policeman bombed that thing out last year or so? City of brotherly love. Well, you know, you can have a title or a name of a city and not even be remotely close to what that name of that city means. Like Philadelphia and Christadelphians. We'll figure it out. Philadelphia, lovers of the brothers, city of brotherly love. Christadelphian, lovers of, it'll be Christ, Adelphos, man, brother. Christ's brothers. That's what the name would mean. You know what they really are? They're not Christ's brothers because they're lost. And that would be measuring them by their own publications, measuring them by what they got out of statements of facts and principles of scripture truth. They're a bunch of lost people like JWs. And so their name, Christadelphian, would be as bad and hypocritical as Christian Science. Really, it would be. It would be. And if you was going to be polite to them, you'd have to say they were Junior JWs. That'd be the polite name. A more scriptural name would be they are the Anti-Christadelphians. They're the Antichrist brothers. That's what they really are. They're lost people. That'd be the correct name for them. Now, this bunch called Christadelphians, a statement of the one faith forming the Christadelphian basis of fellowship. And not a lot of these people, but there are some in our town. Some of y'all had some dealings with them. I've had a little bit of dealings with them. I had a guy I worked with one time. And matter of fact, the fellow's a Christadelphian preacher that makes out my income tax. Not too sure about him, but he does know all the ins and outs, or supposed to know the ins and outs as far as what a man like me can get for a tax break. But I've had some dealings with those people, not a whole lot. And they're about like JWs. They're people that will take a little persecution for what they believe. There are people that you don't seem to be able to accomplish anything with. I've talked to them just as straightforward as I could ever talk to anybody and accomplished nothing that I know of. But they're a movement that started long about the same time as JW's. They were not ahead of JW's, they were behind them, so juniors, you know. And they were a movement that, as far as I can see, began about 1886. Long about 1886. This little booklet here says, "A statement of faith which follows is that which was adopted by the Christadelphian body in 1886. JW is beginning about 1870. Publications begin at about 74, 79, and incorporated in 1884. And so they're a little bit behind JW's, but basically they're JW's. JW's came on, and the fellow had heard a lot of what was going on in the basement there from Seventh-day Adventists and picked up part of their stuff. And this guy comes on, picks up a lot of JW stuff. Christadelphians, and the roots back as far as 1886. Generally speaking, what they believe is essentially JW beliefs. And I'll read some of their stuff to you. It'll be 95-98% JW's. The bigger book by the Christadelphians is they would oppose the JW's along the lines of just four things. You and I would oppose JW's about nearly everything. I mean, we do believe in open air and public witnessing, but that's just about as far as we could connect with JW's. These people get along with them in everything except four areas. I'll talk to you about in a minute. But basically, the Christadelphians believe that there is no actual devil, that he's already been destroyed. You and I understand that the Antichrist is brought to ashes. You and I understand that takes place in the future, not in the past. You and I understand, as far as the devil being destroyed, we know that he's going to a lake of fire, and he'll be there forever and ever. We know that from Revelation chapter 20 and verse number 10. And we know the Antichrist, who's the devil in a body like Jesus was God in a body, we know that he will burn up and be brought to ashes on the earth at the second coming of Jesus Christ. We know now that he's alive and well and doing a job on folks on this earth. They don't believe in a real, sure enough, personal being of the devil. They as well deny the Trinity. Familiar? The cults. They say Jesus Christ was not God the Son, but like the rest of them, just the Son of God, but in no way was he God the Son. They deny heaven and hell, and of course, just like the JWs, hell being the grave. No eternal soul, no torment of a lost soul in a devil's hell, hell being just the grave. All JW material. Baptism necessary for salvation, like JWs, and even stronger along those particular lines. And the amazing thing is, these people talk about salvation and they don't believe in hell. Salvation from what? No eternal soul. Salvation from what? It's wild. All right, they have a wrong emphasis on the kingdom. You and I believe in kingdom, kingdom material, Jesus Christ setting up his kingdom, a 1,000-year reign of Jesus Christ on this earth. We believe the book of Matthew goes right on through, and for 25 chapters it's kingdom, 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 and more kingdom material. We believe that. But they have a wrong emphasis in that all their teaching deals with just kingdom material, or 99% of it does. The Bible has more on the kingdom than it does on salvation. Yet in this day and age, the age of grace, the issue is not the kingdom, it's been postponed. It's been set aside for a couple of thousand years. In this day and age, it's salvation, individual and personal salvation, through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. That's a major issue for this day and age. Okay, bad emphasis. And dealing with the kingdom, they do not know the difference between the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God. They make no distinction. And they act as though we believe the church is the kingdom. We don't believe that. Maybe some do, we do not. They do not get the distinction between the kingdom of heaven, physical and literal, the kingdom of God, which is spiritual and still real. They believe in no personality of the Holy Spirit, just a power and influence, a force. We believe the Holy Spirit of God is personal. We believe he has a personality. The Bible calls the Holy Spirit of God He and Him in John chapter 14, in John chapter 16. And when the Holy Spirit of God is referred to as, and it deals with His work, not His person, not His personality. The Holy Spirit of God does have power. All the wind you saw the other night when Irvin's shanty roof, forgive me for that, Irvin, that slipped too. His shanty, his shed. His wonderful shed that he built and constructed marvelously here a few years ago. We okay now? Still buddies. Okay. A few years ago, he stood there and watched his roof just about blow off, lift up and move or whatever it did, but the wind about took it off. And you saw pictures in the paper. Roger wondered if what he worked on was still standing about 4 o'clock Friday afternoon after he left the job and the strong winds came through. Not a hurricane, but strong winds. Tail end of the hurricane, I guess. I thought about, you know, how that the Holy Spirit of God and the work that He does inside of a lost man when He saves him is likened unto the wind. And you can see the result of that wind. You don't see the wind itself. You see the result of it. Irv didn't see the wind. He saw the roof go up in the air and get peeled back about halfway. But you and I believe in the Holy Spirit's power, but we believe that He's a person, and we believe that He has a personality as well. And they believe in works for salvation. And again, like I say, why believe in salvation if there is no hell? You may as well eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die like a dog and go to the grave like a dog, and they throw dirt on us, and that's the end of it. We live like a dog and die like a dog. Who cares about salvation? But they talk about salvation. The only difference between them and the cults is their claim. The cults are the same along the lines of the Godhead. They mess up especially along the lines of the deity of Jesus Christ. They all claim works for salvation of one form or another. None believe in a Bible hell. All the major cults have their own publications and reject the Bible as being the final authority. This outfit claims to have the Bible to be our guide. Fine and dandy. The only thing about the Bible, man, it's you're dealing with a loaded book. You're dealing with a book that's so powerful that that thing is not treated with prayer. And you don't cry out and say, God, open mine eyes and I might behold wonders, things out of thy law. You can take the scriptures and go to hell with the Bible. In 2 Peter chapter 3, it talks about those that wrest the scriptures to their own destruction. What do they do? They just put the twist on it. Like a wrestling match, you get somebody all twisted up. They wrest the scriptures. They put a twist on them and they go to hell with the Bible. They claim the Bible is their guide, but it is not. It's just something they use as a tool, and they go to hell with the Bible as what they call their guide. Here's why I say what they do. This is not my publication. This is not our church's tracts. This is theirs. This is printed by, believe it or not, same type of name as the Mennonites, the Herald Press, different location. Some of their beliefs. Here we go. Listen now. And it's a drag, I grant you. But listen, maybe something that you need will stick. Man, mortal and perishing, not an immortal soul. Let's see here. Essential first principles of scriptural truth. Man, mortal and perishing. The truth to them is that man is not, and they have it in big letters, outstanding letters, not an immortal soul. And the quotation is passages like Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 19 and 20, Ezekiel chapter 18 and verse number 4. And those verses speak of man as being a soul, but they're Old Testament passages that deal just with physical death. In the Old Testament, the soul and the spirit were stuck together, so much so that when God would speak sometimes of the soul being stuck together, or two being likened unto one, He would speak of it as along the lines of physical death and identify it just as the soul that sinneth, it shall die. Because they were one the same, stuck together. And taking Old Testament passages that just deal with physical death and using those passages to prove the point that they say is scripture truth, that man is not an immortal soul. You know what that is? That's Jehovah Witness teaching. Again, to them scripture truth, the dead are unconscious, not alive in hell or heaven. Their publications, and we judge out of their own mouth. The dead are unconscious, not alive in heaven or hell. And of course, once again, guess where the passages come from? The Bible's our guide. Old Testament passages, such as Psalm 146, verse number 4. Ecclesiastes, of all places, chapter 9, verse 5, 6, and verse number 10. Along those lines, again, is true as far as the Old Testament, even saved person, is concerned. I mean, they went to Abraham's bosom. I mean, there is an element of rest spoken of back there for the Old Testament saint. But whenever the statement is made that the dead are unconscious, implying everybody that dies is unconscious, and nobody goes to hell, and nobody goes to heaven, then they have missed all of the New Testament, because in the New Testament, it's absent from the body and present with the Lord. And the Gospel of Luke, when the rich man died, the next thing you read, and in hell, he lifted up his eyes, not because he was asleep and was wakening up, but being in torments. And you understand that, according to the Word of God, these people, again with J.W. teaching, still are completely in error and believing a lie. Nobody's alive in heaven or hell. That's their publication. Again, listen, I said they're J.W.'s for all practical purposes. They say that like a J.W., that hell is the grave. Hell is the grave. There are not eternal torments. Problem. Revelation chapter 14, verse 10 and 11. The smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever. A lost man goes to hell, and the smoke of his torment ascends up forever and ever, according to the Word of God. And of course, they grab the passages again back in the Old Testament that deal with physical death. They grab a New Testament passage that deals with death for a saved person. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? That deals just with saved people. Lost people die and go to hell, just like Jesus said they do. It's saved people that can make that statement. It's not everybody that can make that statement. It's not lost people that can be said about. Just saved people and saved people alone. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? And of course, Jesus Christ has given victory for those that have received him as their Savior. J.W. teaching just through and through. They say resurrection at the last day, not hell or heaven at death. More J.W. teaching. What they miss is that the soul slips out of the body. They don't seem to get on to that, like the Bible says in Genesis chapter number 35. They say the resurrection is for the responsible only, not all mankind, as though some stay down. Granted, there is a resurrection in which some come up and some stay down. That's true. But there comes a time when those that stay down, 1,000 years later, they come up as well and give account to God, Revelation chapter 20. It's just that there's a period of time separates those resurrections. And it seems like they can't get it. The Bible says in the New Testament, there's a resurrection both of the just and of the unjust. And so they're teaching out of 20 things listed in the pamphlet here, probably 20 for 20 are the same as J.W.'s. At least you could say 18 out of 20 would be J.W. teaching right down the pike. For example, one more time, not to try to wear you slam out, but just for one more time to prove the point. They say the earth is the reward of the righteous, not heaven. And of course, teaching righteousness for salvation. You and I know we have no righteousness of our own that impresses God at all, only the imputed righteousness of Jesus Christ himself. And favorite passage of the JW is their favorite as well. Matthew chapter 5 and verse number 5. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. And of course, you and I have known to rightly divide the word of truth, dispensationalize the verse, knowing that you and I have a chance to come back here on the earth in the millennium and reign as kings and priests on the earth with Jesus Christ, provided we don't blow our inheritance and lose our reward now in the church age. But JW teaching is that no heaven, no hell, into the grave you go. That's all the hell there is. Into the grave you go. And one day, if you lived half decent, one day you'll come out and inherit the earth. But not everybody comes out. Wild teaching of this bunch, and as wild as JW's. Now, they contend with JW's along certain lines. They contend with JW's along the lines of names. It'll be like a Campbellite. Campbellite will talk about how that we are the churches of Christ. And they'll gloat over their name. And where'd you get your name from? And we're the churches of Christ, not John the Baptist. That kind of thing. And I said, well, we're the church of God. The body of Christ, you know, that kind of thing. And just kind of mess them up. And these people, they fuss over the name. JW is, you know, Isaiah chapter 43, and we're his witnesses. And so we're God's witnesses, Jehovah God, Jehovah Witnesses. And these people say they're Christ's brothers. And so they got the wrong name. We got the right name. You know what else is funny? Every one of these bunches of people, cults, nobody was saved all these years at the before we finally got the truth in 1800. Up to that point, nobody could get saved. And now the Mormons are the one true church, and the Latter-day Saints, nobody gets saved outside of that movement. On comes the Seventh-day Adventists, and they're the one true remnant church of the last days. After them comes the Christian Science, and they're the bunch. Comes the JWs, and they're the one only, and forget everybody else. And on comes even the junior JWs. And what do you know? They're the one true bunch to the exclusion of even the Papa JWs. It's wild. It's wild. And they have a contention there with JWs along the lines of the name. Problem with them calling themselves Jehovah's Witnesses. They again contend with them or have problem with them along the line, not too much, but along the lines of the number that are sealed. And of course, the thinking is not too bad at all along the lines of the 144,000. JWs are messed up there. And whenever the publication came out, like I said, 10,900 and some or 10,000, whatever, that's all JWs claim that have already gone on to heaven of the 144,000. Sure are a lot of wicked people, man. If I had a chance to be one of the 144,000, I'd shoot for it. If I was in the movement in which the 144,000 came from, I mean to tell you, man, I'd go for it, wouldn't you? Why not? Bible says, press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. That's the verse they need. But something wrong. They contend with him along the lines of the return of Christ. Where JW say that he came back in 1914, invisibly, they will quote Zechariah chapter 14, verse 4, and say that his feet shall stand the latter day upon the Mount of Olives. And they will talk about Matthew chapter 24 as dealing with the actual literal return of the Lord Jesus Christ to this earth. And they will dispute with him along the lines of the blood transfusion problem. And to the Christadelphian, if they can save the life of the blood transfusion, they would do it. A JW would not. But only in those four things do they have any point of contention with the JW. And most of them really don't mean all that much. But for the most part, they claim in the Bible to be their guide. JW say we have our own Bible, but they will take a King James Bible and use it but twist it. And with it all and through it all, they are still just come down to the bottom of the line as being junior JWs. From the book, The Bible is Our Guide. The Future of the Righteous. This is just at random here, and I won't bore you to death with all of it, but a couple things from the book. If we believe that the righteous go to heaven at death, like you and I, and like the Bible says, 2 Corinthians 5, verse 8, absent from the body, present with the Lord. Philippians 1, verse 23, and 1 Thessalonians 5, verse number 10. How can we believe the Bible which states that the righteous shall be recompensed in the earth? Well, that's easy. That just deals with the millennium. And how can we believe the Bible that says, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth? See that? Still J.W. thinking along those lines. All right, let's sample another one. The kingdom. If we believe that the kingdom of God is the church, and we don't believe that. Never did. If we believe the kingdom of God is the church or in the heart, yeah, true, that's true now in this day and age. Romans chapter 14, verse 17. How can we believe the Bible which shows that it will be a divine political kingdom established upon the earth? Easy. Dispensations. Period of time, God deals with people a certain way. And this particular day and age, kingdom's not the issue. Salvation is. But one day this age draws to a close. One day the curtain comes down. One day we go out. The age ends. You'll go into another dispensation. You go from that. One day it finally concludes and comes to an end. Go to another one. Anybody ought to be able to figure that out. And they have a problem with it. We believe in a literal kingdom on this earth, just like they claim, and yet we still believe the kingdom of God now, all it is in this day and age, is a spiritual kingdom within the believer, Romans chapter 14 and verse number 17. Kingdom, kingdom, and more kingdom, wrong emphasis for this age. Okay? If we believe that there is a personal immortal devil, then how can we believe that Jesus was manifested to destroy the devil? How can we believe that? All right. The day and age in which you and I believe in, live in, what do we believe? Do we have an adversary? Is there such a thing as a real adversary for you and I right now? I mean, even in the tribulation, Peter talks about your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion goeth about seeking whom he may devour. In the day and age in which we live, Paul talks about Satan hindering me. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse number 18. Satan hindered what Paul had going that God wanted to have going. He had an adversary. He had an opponent or opposition. And so you and I believe in a real sure enough devil. Why, you talk about situation in chapter 14. You have something going on there where the Lord is talking to the devil. In Revelation chapter 12, the same thing goes on. He's talking to the devil. Why? Because the devil's making accusation. The accuser of the brethren is there night and day before God. And God just pitches him out even to the second heaven. But he certainly is not destroyed at this point in time. You understand that'll take place later when he goes in the lake of fire and the Antichrist burned up on the earth. And of course the devil goes into the lake of fire, Revelation chapter 20. One more sample here. If we believe that Jesus was God the Son, the deity of Jesus Christ being attacked. Do you believe he's God the Son?
Amen.
Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. A son is given, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father. Son is given. That son that was given is the Everlasting Father. He was, and he is, God the Son. Sure, he's the Son of God, but he's God the Son. Listen, you and I believe that he came not by water, but by water and blood. Not water only. Not just natural birth, but Jesus Christ, the supernatural birth. He had God's blood in him. He was God. He was God the Son. He not just the Son of God. How can we believe the Bible which states that he shall be called the Son of God? Well, it's true that he was called the Son of God, but it's true as well that Jesus Christ was God manifest in the flesh, and that he's the everlasting Father, and that he is God the Son. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6 and verse number 7. They say the Bible teaches that he is Jesus, the Son of God, not God the Son. Resurrectionarianism, again. JWs all the way through. And that's just a sample of their junk that they call Bible being our guide. A sample from this book. Same type of stuff. Only source of knowledge concerning God and His purposes. They do say the Bible being their guide. Talk about Jesus Christ just being the anointed one at His baptism. More foolishness. The gospel. All right, now in Galatians chapter 1, the statement of the Word of God is, if anybody goes astray on the gospel of the grace of God, any other gospel, let him be accursed. We'll deal with one thing, the gospel. That the way to obtain this salvation is to believe the gospel they preached and to take on the name and service of Christ. Christ's brothers take on their name by being thereupon immersed in water. Water in the name of Christ, in the name of Jesus, Acts 2:38. And continuing patiently in the observance of all things he has commanded. Endure to the end, salvation by works. None being recognized as his friends except those who do what he has commanded. Salvation by works and enduring. All right, that the gospel consists of the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ. No mention of the gospel of the grace of God. Verses 8 talk about the gospel are Acts chapter 8, verse number 12. Acts chapter 19, verse 8, 10, 20. Acts 28, verse 30 and verse 31. And they do not talk about salvation by the grace of God and by blood atonement. When I come down to the point of salvation in Acts chapter 8, sure, Peter's preaching to Israel things pertaining to the kingdom of God, or Philip is. But when Philip goes on and takes the individual, Gentile, Ethiopian eunuch, he talks to him about a blood atonement. What are you reading? Oh, yes. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter. Blood atonement. And like a sheep before his shearers is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth. Isaiah chapter 53. And the Bible says he preached unto him the kingdom. He preached unto him Jesus and a blood atonement. Verse 32 and verse number 35. These people, when it comes to the gospel, they're messed up. The gospel they talk about is the gospel of the kingdom. The gospel of the kingdom is identified in Matthew chapter 10. Heal the sick, cleanse the leper, raise the dead, freely have received, freely give, etc., and so on. These people, according to their own testimony, and according to Galatians chapter 1, they messed with the gospel of the grace of God by which a man, woman, boy, or girl is saved in this day and age in which we live. And so doing, the conclusion of the matter is, let him be accursed. Junior JWs is a respectable name. They're still lost as those old wicked witnesses are. Christadelphians, a tag they have, they claim it means a whole lot. And yet there are still anti-Christadelphians, and they'd be against Jesus Christ, and they say he is not God the Son. Therefore, you and I reject them people with all their material as being lost and going to hell. The overview is they're messed up on the kingdom. They're messed up on salvation, baptism for salvation. Hell's the grave. Wrong. Error. Man may go to the grave physically, his body may go there, his soul done gone, and in hell lifts up his eyes, being in torments. Jesus Christ is not God the Son. Oh, yes, he is. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, and other places in the New Testament as well, where Jesus Christ is said to be God, capital G-O-D. So, with the Bible's our guide, they're going to hell. And though they refute a few things, J.W. say, for all practical purposes, they are JWs. And for all practical purposes, they are just as lost as a JW is, though they may be correct in a couple of areas. Yet, according to their own testimony, they're a bunch of lost people going to hell, and we need to witness to them. Excuse me, I can't go on any further. I'm gagging. It's dry. I'm about to get the dry heaves, and before I do, I'm going to close it down. Pitiful, isn't it? Say, yeah, you are a case. Well, not only me, but the more pitiful thing is, they are pitiful and to be pitied. And try your best to steer them aright. Try your best to win them. I've not won any, but maybe you can. Pour your heart out to them. Pray for them. But know that they're no more than junior JWs. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you now for the Word of God, and we thank you, Lord, for the truth, and thank you for the Holy Ghost of God that's able to guide us into all truth. Lord, that our hearts would not be messed up so that, God, you'd pull back from us. And Lord, that we never turn out the light and only go so far and shut you down and say, I don't want to hear that. Lord, that we'd always receive all that you have for us, so you keep on giving more light to us along the way. God forbid that we should get twisted up. God forbid that I should get twisted and messed up, and so doing mess up a church and the ministry you give me, throw it away. And God, I don't know how to deal with these people. I haven't done any good with them. I know where they're wrong. I've got answers for them. They just don't seem to receive anything. I guess evidently they've got to be a horrible mess to even fall for heresy like they do. And God, I don't know what to do, but Lord, I pray you'd help your people to have the heart they need and be wise. And God, once again, I beg you to never let anybody that ever comes through this church and these doors ever get messed up in the movement. Lord, if anybody does, they do it of their own accord. They know better. Lord, we just judge according to their own mouth and their own writings. And God, I just ask you, Lord, to help somebody to be able to win a Jehovah's Witness, a Mormon, a Seventh-day Adventist, a Christian Scientist. Lord, that somebody could get saved, a Christadelphian perhaps, through what's been taught in the last few weeks. God, helps to love your word more and more and appreciate it more and more, and may it be more precious to us than ever. And God, that we never ever take it lightly and twist it and rest it and make it say what we want it to say. God, that it should say just what it does. But Lord, help us to rightly divide the word of truth. Father, we're thankful for it. And thank you, Lord, for those who have died to preserve it. And Lord, that we should preach it and propagate it. And Lord, never corrupt it. God, help us. God, help us. Father, I'm thankful for the Bible, even people I have, and those that are courageous enough to witness, and those that will learn, take notes, and study, and be able to handle these kind of people. God, help them. God, give them opportunities to use this material that I have presented. I know it's been long and hard and dry. God, that they'd have the chance to use it again. In Jesus' name, I do ask it. Amen.